Shalom, ladies, gentlemen, brothers, and sisters. Hope you find this video as informative as it should be. This is a very, very informative video. If you listen, just give me 35 minutes of your undivided attention, and I'm sure you would actually want to watch the remainder of this video, which is approximately an hour and 8 to 10 minutes. So the title of this video, Don't Go to College, Don't Pay Taxes, Incur More Debt, Become a Secure Party Creditor, Stop Me Where I'm Lying At. I myself, Tazadak Shah Bey, is the author of several great selling books. You should get my books, The Inviolable Man, The Corporation, Red Pill Right Knowledge, Commercial Warfare and the Infliction of Commerce, and The Real Hebrew Israelites versus Edom and Khazaria, the newest being The Inviolable Man. One of the most well-known books in the sphere of personal development and how to survive and change your life as a secure party creditor and financial education, correcting your status when being debt-free, also correcting your credit. In this interview that's actually conducted by G Boundless, I shared a few fundamental lessons that's going to help you in growing your financial situation and altering your life for the better. Now, here's some key concepts that's actually asked to me by G Bound in this video. He asked me questions regarding that, you know, the system is sinking. And so I told him essentially, crashes make the rich richer. And so we should learn more about the potential financial crisis and what we could actually do about it by becoming secure party creditors. The number two question that he asked me was, you know, should we be able to understand taxes and so on and so forth? And so I said, you must understand taxes. The rich don't pay taxes. Donald Trump don't pay taxes. Tyler Duck doesn't pay taxes. If you're looking to build your wealth, listen up, brothers and sisters. If you're looking to build your chances, you're going to have to get in a little debt. Do you understand? So your fundamental skill you need to address is accounting, understanding accounting. One of the third questions that, and I'm paraphrasing these questions, he didn't necessarily ask him in these ways. The third question that he asked me, he said, is the ship sinking? Meaning the system. And so if the ship is sinking, essentially what happens, these crashes make the rich richer. And so what I suggested to him is to actually learn more about how to profit on the down market. The fourth thing was Tazadak Shabe's message to the youth. Because my primary objective is to reach the youth. Most of the people that's already programmed and keep hearing that little voice, go to school, pay taxes, buy a house, it's your greatest investment. You keep hearing those little voices, it may be too late for you. Maybe or maybe not, but it's going to be exceedingly difficult to overcome that cognitive dissonance. So Tazadak, I myself tell you to challenge what you've been taught and question authority. And so the fifth question, most people are employees. Is that correct? Yeah. And so most people should remain employees. Most people should not become secure party creditors. Most people should remain debtors because it's an interesting argument of polemics. Since being an entrepreneur, since being self-employed, requires special types of actions and motivations, and you have to be driven. It requires a price. And so what is the price of working for yourself? What is the price of being an entrepreneur? Are you willing to pay that price? So G Boundless and Tazadak had a very interesting conversation, dialogue here. I hope you enjoy it. And so the number one problem, I'm going to say this before we go into the question that G Boundless is actually going to ask myself, Tazadak, in this interview that was actually conducted just a few hours ago. So the number one problem that most people have in their minds is that they must go to college and get a degree. That's your first problem right there. Hindsight shows me Don't attend college. It's a waste of your time. You're just going to incur the wrong type of debt. Student loans are the worst type of debts to have. The second thing, they teach you, your mother teaches you this, your father teaches you this, and your teacher teaches you this. And a teacher couldn't survive the things that I've survived. I know you say, Tyler, Doc, that's opinionated. No, it's not. It's a fact. Their minds are not developed to sustain the things that I've sustained. This is why they're teachers. You understand? So what they tell you is then you get a job. And so if you get a job, what does that mean? That means you're going to give a social security number and you have to pay taxes. And then they tell you to save money and then make an investment in an asset. And then they tell you that a house is an asset. I know people that have PhDs like Dillette, and she believes that a house is an asset. A house is not an asset unless you're going to convert it into some sort of commercial purpose. So what I'm going to say to you is the exact opposite. I don't tell you what everyone else tells you. I speak the truth through the spirit of Yahweh Basham, Yahweh Shah, through the spirit of God in Christ. So I wouldn't go to college if I actually would do it all over again. I would not go to college. Hindsight shows me that we don't learn anything about how to make money work for us in college. We don't learn anything about how to make money work for us in school. I would not get a job. I don't have one now. I'm an entrepreneur. I do for myself. So I would not get a just over broke that you call a job. Because then once you get one, guess what? Then you pay taxes because you become an employee. Employee pays taxes. You see, my family, I don't pay taxes and I don't follow their trend of saving a lot of money. What does saving money do for you? It does nothing. How does saving money help you? You've been lied to. And that voice keeps whispering to you. So it's exceedingly difficult to break the paradigm that's been instilled into you. You see, I became a secure party creditor and I used debt to get ahead. I used debt to get a better credit score. And I discharged it. And I'm damn sure not investing in the stock market, which is what they tell you, which is a mistake. And to all of you under the sounds of my voice, and you just think the opposite of what I'm saying right here because of what your mother taught you, because of what your father taught you, and because of what your educators taught you, I suggest to you, challenge your belief system. Challenge your belief system. Debt is money, right? Credit and debt is essentially the same thing. It's all about bookkeeping, right? So you must learn accounting. Question this hypnotic program that you are under. And so when I say this, question the hypnotic program that you're under, people get upset with me. When I tell people to become a secure party creditor, they say, that doesn't work. Well, it's working very fine for me. It's working fine for me. I'm not in need of anything. And I'm not paying taxes because I'm not a federal employee. I'm not obligated to do so. So when I say this, people become very irate. Well, you're cheating the system. No, I'm not. I'm not an employee. You understand? I'm a free man. I'm an entrepreneur. Do you understand? I know how to effectively deal with debt. This is why I have a perfect credit score and you don't. And most people under the sounds of my voice, the millions of people listening to me right now, don't have a perfect credit score like me. So something's working for me, right? So when I say this, people become irate with me and leave negative comments under my videos. But I challenge you to challenge your brainwashing process and go and check out this information for yourself. And one of the best places you can check it out is to get my new book, The Inviolable Man. But don't just stop there. Get all of them. And you can get these books on my website, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org. The more debt I incur, the less taxes I pay. It's a fact. Now you go and talk to a tax expert and see if I'm lying. And so anywhere in the course of this video, stop me where I'm lying. And right now I'm wearing G-Bound apparel, as you see. G-Boundless, be the best. So you can cop one of these from the man G-Bound. I got it from G-Bound, just showing him some love. Just trying to keep, you know, the money in the circle of the family. So let's tune into this.
All right, shalom, 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 ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. Once again, you're not in the sounds of the voice of your brother Taza Doc and my man, G-Bell.
G-Bell. Republic in the building.
Right. And so I suppose that the good brother got, you know, some questions for me, and I'll try and actually entertain those. And, you know, as soon as you're ready, brother, you can actually start firing away. So the only thing I'm going to say to you is stop me where I'm lying at. Just like the shirt says, stop me where I'm lying at. You know what I mean? And by the way, this is the name of this.
Stop me where I'm lying at, too.
This interview, just stop me where I'm lying at.
Yeah, man.
Okay, so what's on you?
Okay, well, first question I want to ask is, you know, because a lot of people are really skeptical, you know, about the information and where everything begins. So if I know you have a long list of videos that people can go check out, but can you just give us an overview of how the secure party process started?
You mean how it started for me, or how does it start?
Like what made it? Well, how did it start for you? Because you know, different people have different you know, takes on what it's used for. So you know, some people just want to discharge debt, but some people are in in legal trouble. But you know, so I think there's a lot of confusion about what exactly a secure party creditor is, or secure party slash creditor is. So could you clarify exactly what it is?
Yeah, so the secure party creditor is actually, so when we was actually born, any of us that was actually born in a hospital, and even those that was actually born at home, that actually was actually born through a midwife that's actually registered through the state. Whether you're born at home or you're born in a hospital, and if you have someone that's actually, even a midwife, if they're registered through the state, it's their duty and responsibility to report to the state that another collateral that, you know, they call, children was actually born, that actually becomes state property. And the reason that I say they become state property, because they report that live record of both, and then that family is actually contact to apply for the birth certificate. In fact, the midwife would tell me, you got to fill out this paperwork and so on and so forth. And so if the midwife doesn't do that, then they're in, you know, jeopardy of actually losing the ability to continue to be a midwife. And obviously, if you're born in a hospital, you know, not necessarily the father, sometimes they have the father son, but usually it's not important. It's generally the mother that they want to fill out the live record of birth information. And so even if she's married, they want her maiden's name. And so with that live record of birth information is actually sent over to the Department of State, and from that, a birth certificate is actually created on bond paper. And so one of the interesting things about that, when this birth certificate is created on bond paper, they pronounce a name similar to your appellation that you think is your name, but it's actually in all capital letters. On any state issue document, Social Security, any governmental ID, it's always written in capital letters. So now what essentially just occurred is that you gave the state power of attorney over you. Now, you was too young to realize this, so your mom informed the state that she had more property for the state, and that baby now became property of the state, which explains why the state could send out Child Protective Services and seize their property that you signed over to the state voluntarily without actually being aware of it. So how do you get out of this? Because now you're subject to all of the things that fall under the state, which has actually become a trust by way of Washington, D.C. So the state is no longer a sovereign state. The state has actually become a franchisee of Washington, D.C., which is actually a trust, which is a corporation. So now all of the statutes, codes, rules, acts, regulations suddenly apply to us because we just declared ourselves as a United States citizen. And then you go to school and they dumb you down more because they tell you that you're not a United States citizen, but they don't tell you exactly that the United States that they're referring to is Washington, D.C., and not the 50 states. You understand? So we just gave the state jurisdiction, and then we'll go in court and we'll argue, but we'll wonder why we always lose and wonder why the judge always say, hey, you need to get a representative, is because once we actually give the state this power of attorney over us, we are actually acknowledged as incompetent wards of the state. Someone that's incompetent is like what they refer to as a retard, someone that's actually not capable of speaking for themselves. You're also acknowledged as a minor. That means you're like an infant. So, you know, if you had a 2 weeks old baby, can he go to court and speak for himself? No, he cannot. So a representative goes in to speak for him because he is a minor. He is an infant. So once we become that state property, we're looked at as minors, as infants. And so remember, they operate off a presumption, so everyone is presumed to be the same. So where does the secure party creditor come in yet? That was your question. So in order to get out of this corporate ward status of being a minor and an infant, we have to take back power of a attorney from the state. And so we do that by putting certain organizations and people on notice saying that, hey, I am not an incompetent ward of the state. I am not a minor because this is dealing with status, right? But I am a living soul. I am a man, and I'm actually competent enough to handle my own affairs. And so when you do something like that, you're looked upon as a radical because we're actually all been programmed to think, hey, everyone else is doing it. This is the right way. This is what we're supposed to do. We never stop to question authority and say, hey, why am I doing this? Why does everything turn out this way? So in order to get from under that, you become a secure party creditor. Now, the mistake that a lot of people make is they become a secure party creditor because they just want to discharge debt. And so when they go into it from that paradigm, you even have some people that believe that they could actually go in and withdraw money. So I tell them, how can you do that when there's no money? Money was taken out of circulation in 1933 with House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310, 48, Statute 48. So the only thing we can do is set off or discharge the debt because they took away our ability to pay anything in 1933. But at the same time they did that, they gave us a resolution, but they did not have to tell us the resolution because they had plausible deniability. But in order to do this, you have to be in a proper status. And so the only way to get in a proper status is to become a secured party creditor, taking back power of attorney, taking, you know, rescinding all of those contracts that we sign into voluntarily, but without full disclosure. So this is why it's important to be a secured party creditor, not so I can get all this fiat, but to put yourself back into a proper status, then you can stand as a man, and then essentially that doesn't apply to you once you become a secure party creditor, because these rules, these acts, these statutes, they only apply to those corporations that created them and those people that consent. So the problem is each and every one of us consent out of ignorance because we believe this is what we're supposed to do, when in fact, that's just not the truth.
Right. Okay, now my next question would be, you just like you just said, we consent ignorantly. Now, how are some of the ways that we do consent ignorantly, like what are some of the contracts we can enter into after we do our secure party process that'll put us right back into the system?
Oh, case in point, going to apply for a Just Over Broke, which is my acronym for a JOR, because once you have it, you're still just over broke, right? So when you go and apply for a job, what is the first thing that the human resources department asks you for? First thing, I stop and say, damn, why are we going to a human resource department? Are we human resources? Yes, yep. We're collateral. So when you go into the human resources department, they ask you for your social security number. And so once you use that, that makes you a part of that trust. So immediately, as soon as you go, and most people, they're not told that this is not mandatory. And so all it requires is that for someone in the human resources department to challenge them, say, you got to give us this or you can't work. And so what they're really doing is a fraud, because they can't say that to you because you're not required, nor is it mandatory for someone to actually use a social security number in order to get a Just Over Broke. They force them, you know, by ignorance to do that. And so as soon as they do that, you could be a secure party creditor or whatever. As soon as you do that, you go right back into debtor mode. So you just put yourself right back into the trust. But if people will watch my videos on the channel, Deprogram Enlightener, I gave the statutes and codes that say you really don't have to use a social security number. So all they really have to do is use their acts and their codes against them. But most people don't do that when they say, hey, well, this is the way it is. You're a radical. Because when you challenge this, you're looked upon as a radical. And you're looked upon as a troublemaker. Well, roger that. I guess I'll just have to be seen as a troublemaker and a radical, when in reality, I'm just standing up and asserting my rights, given to me by the Creator, not given to me by government. How can a government give me something that, you know, it doesn't have the power to do so? How can a government give me something when I'm the sovereign that gave the government its power? The government's power comes from we the people. But we've been so dumbed down in school, we think it's actually in the reverse, when it's really not. And so when you tell these public servants, because that's what every government worker, every policeman, and so on and so forth is, they're public servant. When you tell these public servants that, they get irate. You know why? Because they've been trained just the opposite. Hey, we're in charge. And that's the message that they're sending to people. And this is why you see these shootings and the police get away with it, is because they use that as a method of engendering fear into the mass mind. And so they could stop this overnight if they wanted to, but there's a reason that it doesn't stop.
Okay. Yeah. And just like, you know, I got a ticket on my way back from the seminar in Cleveland.
Right.
And so during that stop, I wasn't argumentative with the, you know, with the constable on patrol. I wasn't argumentative with him. I told him I would identify myself, you know, based on his proof of claim that he has some sort of authority based on a tax identification number, or if, you know, he could identify himself through his identification card, something other than, you know, the flashing lights or something behind me to prove that he had the authority to do what he was doing. Right. And so he presented me with his business card. And so I took that, and I didn't want to be argumentative and combative, because I know a lot of the times when we do that, they're looking for a reason to, you know, to use that thing on and support a hammer out. And,
right. Absolutely.
So I just wanted to survive the encounter. So I did give them identification. It wasn't a driver's license, and I did tell them I didn't have a driver's license. And so he, you know, wrote me a ticket out, whatnot. But at the same time, he didn't sign it. And he never asked me to sign it either. Okay, now, even without doing a private administrative remedy, like I did on that process, would that stand up in court because he didn't sign that ticket, or he never asked me to sign it?
Well, no one's assuming any kind of responsibility, right? Where's his proof that, I mean, other than, you know, him saying it, where's the proof that you was actually there since you didn't sign the ticket? You see what I'm saying? Someone else could have been operating the conveyance that the state has registered to you. You see what I'm saying? Since he didn't really have, if you didn't present a so-called driver's license to him, how could he actually even identify you by image unless, you know, he has a picture of you at the drive a motor vehicle or something when he went back to his computer. But long story short, if he didn't sign it, then there's no one actually assuming any kind of responsibility, right? Because his signature is essentially what makes it valid. You see what I'm saying? And again, it's just an offer. You know what I mean? He just made you an offer. And so you simply just made him a counter offer. Okay. Well, you're making me an offer to these. Well, actually, I exist outside of this jurisdiction. Like, what's the jurisdiction, first of all, that he had to stop you? See, he stopped you on the presumption that you're a driver, right? Well, this guy's a driver. And since you're a driver, you're supposed to have a driver's license. Well, yeah, I have that piece of plastic, but I'm not operating under that particular capacity at this particular moment. You see what I'm saying? I have one, and when I want to operate in commerce, then I'll use that. But today, I just happen not to be transporting goods or passengers. You see what I'm saying? I'm just simply going from point A to point B. Do I need this piece of plastic if I'm walking down the block? No. If they tell me I do, then I'm going to tell them you're infringing on my freedom of liberty, which is reserved by the Fourth Amendment. You see what I'm saying? Right. So did you not take an oath to uphold the Constitution of the Republic? Yes, you did. You took one of the Republic and you took one of the state. You see what I'm saying? So yeah, either way, I'll get it, man. There's always ways around, but I always give them a counter offer. For every offer they're trying to give me, 99% of the time is going to be a counter offer for me because I don't like what they have to offer me.
Yeah. Right. Now, as far as, going into court to represent yourself.
Which court? Which court are you talking about? The basketball court, the tennis court? Which court? I mean, because court is a game. Understand that.
Right. Like,
you're talking about the basketball court, the tennis court. Which court?
We're talking about the Admiralty court.
Colorable court. Okay, I understand.
Yeah,
okay.
We're talking about the ship. We're talking about traffic court or, right. You know, state court, child support, family court. When we go into court to so-called represent ourselves, what jurisdiction is it that we are waiving our rights to once we step in without making a special appearance?
Well, see, here's the thing. It goes back, and this is why I was putting out these last videos about knowing who you are, right? If I am an American national, am I obliged to go into those courts? No, I'm not. Because first thing I'm going to do is hold all of these people to their oaths of office, right? They all took an oath to uphold the Constitution, right? So what I know from the Constitution is there's only two types of jurisdiction. There's a jurisdiction under the common law, and there's a jurisdiction under maritime admiralty law. Am I obliged to go in under maritime admiralty law? No, I'm not. So, knowing thus, I look at the Bill of Rights, and I use it against them. Now, I'm going to ask you, and it's rhetorical, if I go into a traffic court, where's the trial by jury? If it exceeds $20, does not the Seventh Amendment and the Bill of Rights says that if it's at $20 or more, I'm entitled to a trial by jury? Where's the jury in a traffic court? It's not there. You know why? Because it's a colorable court. It doesn't have any real substance under the law, Constitution being the supreme law of the land. If it's a criminal offense, I'm still entitled to a trial by jury. This is why you see in all criminal cases, a jury's there. You see what I'm saying? But when you start to deal with traffic, child support, those are not legitimate courts, man, because there's no jury. These kind of courts only apply to United States citizens, and me not being a United States citizen, me being an American national, indigenous to the land, Israelite, more, you know, indigenous, It doesn't apply to me. So that those things only apply to people that don't know who they are and people that consent. So what happens, you're going there, they're trying to railroad you, and they're trying to use fear tactics to force it to apply to you. So when they try that with me, hey, I say, hey, man, you took an oath to uphold the Constitution of the Republic, or you warring against the Constitution. Because if they try and force me to go into this kind of court, they're warring against the Constitution. Because if you're going to tell me I got to go into a child support court, I'm going to say, where's my jury? Where's my jury? Being an American national, I'm entitled to a common law jurisdiction. Supreme Court ruling, several of them said that. So, hey, those are not official courts, man. Those are colorable courts. See, it seems like the law. It sounds like the law, but it's not law. It's colorable. There's a resemblance, but it's not law. Sounds like these people are talking law, but they're not. They're talking statutes, codes, rules, regulations. They're not law. Keep this in mind, man. This is one way, one surefire way to determine whether or not something is law. A law is designed to protect someone, right? So that means if I'm violating the law, I have to either be injuring another man or woman, damaging someone's property, or I created some kind of mischief in a contract. Those are the only ways to break the law. If I haven't done that, what I did is offend some code, some statute, all to which I must agree for it apply to me. But the thing is, people just keep consenting. If you don't consent to anything, they don't have anything on you. If you're not a stand-on.
Right. Now, say they do railroad you in that court and tell you the Constitution doesn't apply in the courtroom, and they try to.
I don't belong there then. Check this out, King. The only thing you're going into these courts for is to challenge jurisdiction. You're not even going in to discuss the merit of the case. Well, Mr. So-and-so, you was driving for the light. I object. Show me how you have jurisdiction over me. I challenge subject matter jurisdiction, right? Show me your delegation of authority. What gives you jurisdiction over my person? What gives you jurisdiction over the subject matter? Because I exist outside of this society. I am not a United States citizen. I am American national. Now you show me how you got jurisdiction over me. What law have I broken? Because I'm going to take them right back to their 14th Amendment. It says it has to be an injured party, right? What if I injured? If it's criminal, okay, where's the corpus delicti? If it's civil, where is the contract that I violated? If I haven't done one of those, hey, man, I don't belong here. Who has a verified claim against me that's going to take the stand under oath? And affirmation means they're going to have to swear or affirm what they're stating is the truth. Who's going to do that? The attorney can't do that. I don't even talk to attorneys, man, because everything that they say is hearsay. You see what I'm saying? That's just like asking an infant, how old are you? You see what I'm saying? That's just like asking an infant, what's your name? It's third party. Someone else told you that. And they told you so much that you started to believe that was your name. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Gainsaying, man.
So, could you go into explaining the difference of, say you want, you're injured. Say you're injured, the police take your car. The officer takes your car and he tows it and he takes you to jail for driving without a license. Now, that didn't happen to me, but say that, in that scenario, and I go back and say, okay, well, you violated my civil rights, and so in a private capacity, I want to sue you in court. So I'm gonna take it to the next level, and go after a civil right violation. Can you explain the difference between the Title 42 and the Title 18 violations that happen in the court, and how we're how it's not really meant for us to go into these Title 42 courts?
Well, I'm not going to, first of all, it's very unlikely that I'm going to sue for civil rights. Civil privileges, because they give them to us and they can take them away. and they're going to decide whether or not that's actually been violated. So what I'm probably going to sue them for is for theft, for stealing my property and creating a hardship in my life. Because now you took my conveyance, you deprived me of my automobile, I may not have been able to get to my place of business, and so on and so forth. So now you're calling me an intentional hardship, and I'm going to sue you for that. You see what I'm saying? And I'm also going to sue for theft. You stole my property. No one, the maximum law states, no one has more right to my property than myself. See, unbeknownst to a lot of these people, they say, that doesn't belong to you, it belongs to the state. Well, if I have it on a damn UCC-1 with a lien against it, it belongs to me, listed on my security agreement. I have a commercial lien on it. So if the state wants to come and take it, they have to satisfy the lien. I'm not making this up. I'm using their own statutes and codes against them. The maximum law states first in line, first in time. That means if I have a lien on some property first, I don't care who comes. You have to satisfy my lien first. You understand? So if I have a $10 million lien on my car, then my car is worth $10 million before they can take it from me. So all of the other stuff about the title 42, 19, 82, and title 18, I try to really stay away from their UCC codes unless I'm using against them, showing them that, hey, you violated this and you could spend up to 2 years in jail. You see what I'm saying? Because when we try and use their codes and stuff, they can really try to come at us for that because their codes belong to them and they might try and start to say, hey, you're practicing law and you don't have a license. We know they don't have a license either. So when I use these things, I try to like be specific about what I use. I try and keep it very simple and precise. You stole my automobile, not my motor vehicle, because that's a whole different animal. That means it's used for commerce. But my automobile or my conveyance, you created a hardship in my life. Now I'm going to charge you. And guess who I'm going after? I'm going after the constable on patrol, man. And I'm going after the tow truck company also. You understand what I'm saying? I don't care. You shouldn't have listened to this so-called peace officer or whatever. You should have thought about it. That's my property. You stole my property. You caused me an intentional hardship. Now I'm going to sue you.
Right.
So simple, man.
Okay. Now, as far as going into the discharging the debt side of it, could you go into explaining why someone shouldn't just jump into it thinking they're going to be able to discharge a debt, you know, right away without studying this information and knowing what to do from A to Z?
Well, I mean, because fact of the matter is, chances are they're always going to challenge you, right? And so when I say challenge, again, it's just an offer. Just like every time someone sends you a bill, it's just an offer. Hey, Mr. G-Bound, pay us $120 for your electric bill. It's an offer. Or pay us $350 for the credit card. It's an offer, right? I could turn it into a true bill and send it back. You understand what I'm saying? So why people shouldn't jump into this is because they don't comprehend offer and acceptance. So people will try and go and discharge something, and then it's sent back to them, and then they say, hey, Tyler, the docket didn't work. And then I say, well, it worked for me every time. So the reason that it didn't work, because when they made the people offer to discharge the debt, they got made a counter offer, and that counter offer just froze them. They didn't know what to do from there. And so when the people sent back their counter offer, hey, we don't accept this kind of payment. This is frivolous paperwork. You could spend, you shall spend up to 2 years in prison for this and pay a $20,000 fine. Mine just start going all over the place. I'm going to leave this stuff alone. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, can you go into
that? They made was a counter offer to them. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, now can you go into, you know, if they don't send it back, and they keep it, and say about 3 weeks later, they act like they never got paid?
Well, I mean, so acceptance, right? If we define it in Black Law's dictionary, acceptance, the key part to remember is that it forms a binding contract, right? If I send something to you and you don't do anything, that's known as acquiescence. Acquiescence is also known as agreement, which is actually acceptance. And acceptance and contract law forms a binding contract. So if I sent them an acceptor for value, and I always sent a cover letter giving them a specific amount of time that they have to respond. If they don't respond within that specific amount of time, now they're in default. So, hey, man, when they send me something back, hey, this was accepted on such and such date. You see what I'm saying? Now right. You're in default. I don't want to hear about you don't accept this type of payment, because if they didn't accept it, they would have sent back my original, right? You know what generally happens? They'll make a copy and they say, here, we're sending your paperwork back. Hold on. That's not the original with my wet ink signature. So what they done is they got paid and they want you to pay it again, just like the car dealership does, just like the loan office does, and so on and so forth. And the average person, just do it. And they be sitting back like a fat rat because they kept it. If they keep it, real simple, they've been paid. Acceptance forms a binding contract. So if I worded that correctly, you have 10 days to respond with this, or this debt is considered to be set off, settled, and closed. Acquiescence is agreement. You don't respond within 10 days, he's been paid. Doesn't matter if he could. They do the same thing to us, man. Hey, you're $150. They send you three notices. Third notice, you don't answer. They take it to court, get a default judgment against you. Then that thing hits your credit report.
Right. Now, say they do get a default judgment, or after the third time you don't respond and you get their summons to go to court.
If they get a default judgment, it's done. It's done. That means the court's actually already ruled on it. It's going to hit your credit report. Then they're going to try and start garnishing your wages.
Okay. Now, isn't that an offer also?
What, to garnish your wages?
The judgment?
Well, no. I mean, so they gave you an opportunity, right? So a judgment, you're really not going to be able to stop that, right? That's something that's actually already gone through. That's already been agreed on. Because in order for someone to get a judgment against you, they had to put you on notice first. So if you ignored three notices, then you were judged. You deserve to have that judgment against you. You see what I'm saying? Because they gave you an opportunity to respond. If you don't respond, that's known as acquiescence.
Right. And it works the same way for them than it does for us, right?
Same way, man. Okay. But here's the thing, man. The reason that they still win is most people don't show up in the court. And they know this. They know the average person is not going to show up in the court. So they win by default. I can almost guarantee you that people will start to go to court. You know what they're going to do? They're going to try and settle out of court. Because it's going to cost them way more if it goes into the court. So they're trying to settle out of court.
All right. Now, my next question would be, what is the difference between a third-party debt collector and a collection agent for an alleged creditor? Like, say, from Capital One says, you know, I have a Capital One card and I don't pay on it for about 3 or 4 months and go into default and they close this account up. And they contact me a few times and I don't answer, whatnot. And probably 4 or 5 months down the road, I get contacted by somebody that's not Capital One. What's the difference between, you know, a Capital One collection agent and like a third party debt collector?
Yeah, so the collections agency is usually always someone that either works for the original creditor, the person that allegedly loaned you something, or the original creditor hired them, which is perfectly illegal, right? And so what the Fair Debt Practice Act states is that the original creditor has 180 days to collect on a bad debt, right? Or a debt that's in default. So if they don't collect on it within that time frame, 180 days, they could either take a tax write-off. So instead of them having to pay 39% at tax time, they could pay from 10 to 2%. So they're getting paid hand over fist. So it's always in their favor when you don't pay on a debt, because they could take a tax write-off and they will earn a lot more money that way, or they could write it off as a bad debt. And once the debt has actually been written off as a bad debt, it becomes illegal for them to contact you anymore, and it becomes illegal for a debt collector to try and contact you. But the debt collector is a whole different animal, right? The debt collector is usually some lawyer that started some debt collecting business. And so what he does, he doesn't buy the debt. He buys the information. So he goes online, buys the information, and then they'll often lie and say, hey, we work for Capital One, which is that right there is breaking the law. You can sue him for that. So if the debt has actually been written off, for every time that they've actually contacted you, you could actually sue them $1,000 per offense. And if they're lying, you could sue them for that. If they're not authorized to practice law in your state, you could sue them for that. And these people, they violate the laws all of the time, but they know that people don't know, so they get away with it. So the debt collector, he's not even authorized to contact you whatsoever. So the way that they get away with it is when they call you, they're trying to get you to pay a small amount, and people don't say, who the hell are you? Can you show me why I have a contract with you? You understand? Let's do a debt validation here. Who are you? Right. Are you willing to swear under oath that you work for Capital One? If not, you don't contact me anymore.
Right. I had a debt collector. They called me. I answered the phone. And they told me that they worked for one of my old creditors. And so I asked
them. How old was the debt?
Oh, the debt was over a year old, you know. So I know that it had been charged off at that point. And I asked them, okay, for their tax identification number via W-9. And then I also asked them, you know, by what authority were they attempting to collect this debt, because we didn't have a contract. And they told me, through some clause in my contract with my former alleged creditor, I signed an agreement that they would be able to collect from me. And they ended up, you know, they bought the debt or whatnot. And so I sent them, you know, they sent me out an offer. I sent them a counteroffer. And then I had them, you know, I sent the affidavit along with my counteroffer, telling them to sign, you know, under commercial liability, that, you know, they were, you know, certified and authorized to collect this debt, you know, through, you know, your financial officer or somebody that was, you know, willing to take commercial liability.
Right.
And they never signed the affidavit. But they called me again after that trying to collect on this debt again. So could you go into what somebody could do, you know, if they're not willing to honor, you know, I know you said earlier that we can give them three times to,
not a third party, right? So, first of all, in your notice that you sent them first, I would have made it plainly clear. I would have told them over the phone, don't contact me anymore by phone. If so, it's going to be considered to be harassment. Now, if they contact you again by phone, now they're in violation of the Telephone Communication Act, right? Also, I will ask them, are you using an automatic dialer to call me? If they're using an automatic dialer to call you, again, they're in violation of the Telephone Communication Act. That's $500 per offense. If they've been warned, that jumps up to $1,500 per offense, right? And so you got to really enforce this, right? So if they're not using an automatic dialer, they're going to have to prove that in court. Because the fact of the matter is, most of these people that call you, they use an automatic dialing. What I mean by that, they have a computer just dial a random number, and that's why they don't call you from the same number most of the time. You see what I'm saying? And so the other thing, this guy that you was dealing with, the debt collector, I wouldn't have sent them anything. You know, if I sent them something, it would have been a cease and desist, because I would have told him, if you have such a contract, then you send me that contract that you're alleging that I signed with my wet ink signature. Because if he indeed have a contract with the original lender, then he had that with your signature, and my fingerprint should be on it also, unless I did it online. You see what I'm saying? If he doesn't have that, he's lying, and I'm going to charge him with fraud, and I'm going to charge him with contacting me. I'm going to charge him. So what you need to do is check and see if the debt has been written off, right? if the debt's been written off, everything he's doing is illegal. You see what I'm saying? Right. Every single thing that he's doing is illegal, but I would stop the phone calls instantaneously. Don't call me again. If you communicate with me, let it be by mail and certified mail. You see what I'm saying? At whatever, you know, I probably wouldn't even give him a physical address. I would give him a P.O. box or something. At this right here, certified mail. You understand? And the only thing he would be contacting me for is to do a debt validation, right? And so, and when you do a debt validation in the form of an affidavit, if he hasn't answered point by point, then he hasn't answered it. I don't care if he skipped one of the questions, he hasn't answered it. You see what I'm saying? And so now, hey man, you're going into default right now. So he's probably violating. Most of the times, man, I'm telling you, man, debt collectors, when it gets to the point that they're contacting you, the debt is usually written off, man. It's usually written off. Right. And they lie. They lie and pretend they work for the company.
Right. I hadn't heard from the company in a long time, and I did an administrative process, you know, with the original alleged creditor before they contacted me anyway. And, you know, and that ended up falling off my credit. And then they told me that I reopened up, you know, the account again. I'm like, I didn't reopen up anything, you know, so I knew they were lying right off the bat. But, okay, going into my next question, I know you were talking about, you know, your thumbprint, you know, putting your thumbprint on a document. Can you go into what's the importance of having a notary and a witness, you know, when you do any of these commercial processes?
Well, I mean, the notary pretty much have the same power as a Secretary of State, right? And so the second thing is that you could use the notary to put the contents in the envelope or whatever you're sending out as a proof of service, right? So they can't lie and say they didn't receive it. So now you got them as a witness, and if it has to really physically go to court, now you can subpoena them to come to court. Really, if the notary mailed it, you don't even really have to go to court. You could actually have the notary go in your stead because they mailed it. You see what I'm saying? So that's literally keeping it in the private when you're dealing with a notary instead of taking it over into the public where you got to go into the court.
Okay, so I should have prepaid the postage then and then just give it to the notary to mail out?
Yep.
Okay.
I will let him put it in the envelope and anything.
Okay. Now, my next question would be, when you're dealing with online contracts, say I'm filling out a credit application online.
Yeah.
How can I do that without waiving my rights? Or how can I reserve my rights on those type of applications?
I don't, what do you mean, like, waiver your rights?
Okay, like, say
if you put something online, they there's no way that they can actually say that that's really you. You see what I'm saying?
Okay.
Even if they trace it to your IP address, you see what I'm saying? It could have been someone on your computer. You see what I'm saying? Unless right. they're really looking at me through a damn camera and say, yo, that was someone that really resembles you. I could say, hey, someone got on to my computer and created it under my name. You see what I'm saying? Those right. are easy, man. Those are okay. easy pieces.
All right. Now, as far as, okay, going into getting a home. Okay, I meet with the agent, look at a house. I decide that I want to purchase his home. Okay, we go sit down at the signing table. I sign a promissory note. And then I sign a deed of trust. How should I reserve my rights in that transaction? Because there's, you know, like there's a stack of papers to do.
Read the entire contract. Take it home and tell them you want to read it. That's going to be a deal breaker right there. Because they're going to see, they're going to know that if this guy reads all of this, there's no way he's going to agree to it. Read the entire contract and then reserve your rights on it. UCC 1-308, that's what I would do. So, okay. I mean, the reason I'm saying read the entire contract, because what contract law states, if there's something there you don't agree with, you strike a line through it and you write in what you agree with, they're not going to want to sign it after that. They're not going to want to submit it after that. You see what I'm saying?
Okay.
Because they won't be able to foreclose on you. See, when you do these contracts, they have you sign something to say if you don't pay the mortgage, they could foreclose on you. If you read it, you're gonna scratch through that and say, I don't agree with this. You can't, you're gonna scratch through, we can't, you cannot foreclose on me. You see what I'm saying? They, right. I don't wanna take that.
Okay.
Move to us, man.
So, okay, so say it's a house we really want. Should we try to go through another agent or go through another administrative process?
Well, here's the thing. Here's the thing, man. If you're really trying to get this and you don't want to get foreclosed on, I would do it the right way. I would not allow my emotions to overcome that. I would just let them know from the straight gate, listen, I know how this goes down. You're not loaning me anything. If you're saying that you're loaning me something, show me the books where you're loaning me something. And the first thing I would say to them, this is the problem that I had. Can you loan me someone else's money? Banks can't loan me someone else's money. They can't. Right. Because that's my money, supposedly, right? So, right. And banks can't lend their own money. So how are you loaning me anything? You see what I'm saying? They right. don't have that much amount of money to loan. You see what I'm saying? So the only thing they're doing is balancing the books. So what they're allegedly lending you is credit based on your energy. You see what I'm saying? So right. they're not really giving you anything. You see what I'm saying? There's really nothing tangible that they're giving you. They're just saying that you have credit for this. And guess where it's coming from? It's coming from the promissory note that you created. So right. they take that promissory note and they go and create an account under the name that sounds like yours. And then whoever the property belongs to, they pay them. So now they're out of the picture. So this is why you're paying the alleged lender back, whoever the company is alleging that they loaned you something, and not the person that the property belonged to. You see what I'm saying? Because they've been right. paid. So they're out of the picture.
So what they're doing is a process, what they call novation. Then yep. they're substituting another debt for something that's already been, you know, it's already been settled and closed, right?
Yep.
Okay, so the conversion process of the promissory note, you know, from once you deposit that into a demand deposit, how can I reserve my rights? You know, how could one reserve their rights, you know, before signing something like that?
Well, I mean, I seriously doubt if they will allow you to do that, because then the promissory note wouldn't be effective. You see what I'm saying? It wouldn't be, they wouldn't be able to do anything with it. So I seriously doubt that they would actually allow something like that. See, instead of like saying, hey, I'm gonna reserve my rights on this, I would say, Is not this promissory note paying for the property? Then why do you want me to pay for it again with Federal Reserve notes, which is actually going to incur more debt? Because if the promissory note is not paying for the property, then ask them, why do I have to sign it? Why do you need me to sign it then if it's not paying for the property? Promissory note's paying for the property.
All right. See, you gonna make it over there, man? You looking a little weird.
I'm getting kind of tired, but I'm a few more questions, man. I still gotta eat, man. But it's all good. It's rolling the film, man.
Okay. Yeah, man. Shoot. Only have a couple more left anyway. Now the next question is over. Okay, I process going into court. Like I said, I got the ticket coming back from the creditor conference. Mm-hmm. Now, I did a process. I said,
hey, yo, man, niggas get tickets a day, B. You be all right. But go ahead, man.
Well, so I did a process on it. And, you know, I was telling my family members, you know, about the process I did on it. They're worried about, you know, somebody coming back on me, you know, and I, you know, coming back on me and trying to arrest me after I did my process, because I told them, well, no, I went straight directly to the clerk of courts within the 72-hour period after I got, you know, after I got the ticket. And I told him what I did on the process and whatnot. And then, you know, doing the UCC-1 on it also. Now, can you give them some reassurance. I mean, I know I talk to them until I'm blue in the, until they blue in the face, but tell people why there's nothing to worry about if you get somebody, you know, a counter offer stating they have 10 days to respond, or you'll consider that the matter settled, set off, and closed.
Well, so first of all, you're not someone that doesn't want to believe. What I've learned is you can't convince them of nothing. I gave up trying a long time ago. But here's the thing in my head. So, like, for them to say you can't respond would actually be able to take away your right of due process of law, right? You have a right to respond to something, right? And you don't have to respond the way that they want you to respond with Federal Reserve notes, right? So the only thing essentially that you've done was really make them a counter offer and say that prove your point. So, I mean, basically, what you're saying is that this doesn't apply to me. I wasn't driving. I was going from point A to point B. You know, prove otherwise. That's all that you're really saying, right? And so me, I don't make statements, right? I ask questions. You can't get in trouble for asking questions. This is how you get these people. You ask them questions. You ask things in the form of a question. And hey, is it not true that I have a freedom of liberty? You see what I'm saying? To go from point A to point B, there's your right to travel right there. Most people don't understand what that comes from. That comes from the Fourth Amendment. But if you don't read the Constitution, you don't know this. So long story short, you can't get in any trouble for this. Like, and how's someone going to come and arrest you because you submitted a response? You see what I'm saying?
Right.
To something that you can't, people don't get arrested. And the other thing, I was stopped. Let's say hypothetically something like that would happen, right? So I would say, hold on. Is this civil? And it has to be civil, right? Because money is involved, right? Because supposedly criminal is punishable by jail, right? So right. It has to be civil. You're asking me for money, right? So if it's a civil action, a debtor's prison is supposed to be illegal, right? It has to be something criminal if you want to lock me up. So the semantics that the judge tries to play say, well, contempt. We'll find them in contempt. So if someone's trying to come and get you on a civil action, hold on. First, you got to give me an opportunity to pay. You see what I'm saying? To arrange some payment plan. But if it's civil, that also has to mean that there's a contract that was violated. Show me the contract that I violated. So they're going to say, well, you the driver's license. But hey, I wasn't operating under that capacity, or I'm not entitled to that benefit, right? Or I don't have one. See, remember, they operate on presumption, right? So if you had a driver's license, and let's say if your driver's license is actually suspended, they operate off of the presumption that, well, he has one. He just hasn't renewed it yet. You see what I'm saying? So you have to eliminate that presumption by going down and filling out the proper paperwork and say, I don't want this anymore. I surrender it. Or if you decide to keep it, you got to let them know, I understand what a driver is. I understand what a traveler is. Are you telling me that in order for me to go anywhere, I need this piece of plastic? How can you dictate that to me, right? When I have a freedom of liberty. You see what I'm saying? But people don't understand this because people don't know the law. They just think because these people say something, that's it. That's law. It's not how the law works, man. The Constitution is the supreme law of the land. So when these people do something, any kind of colorable law that they create that's in opposition to the Constitution, says it's not law. It's not law. Because they're warring against the Constitution, which is treason.
Yeah,
that's how we own it.
I tried to tell her, look, there's nothing to worry about. They're more worried about it than I am. You feel me? So I was like, well, you know.
That's straight debtor mode, man. That's debtor.
You know, nobody's coming. You know, don't worry. You know, but, you know, they want me to do a process, a status correction process for them. But I told them I don't think they were ready for it.
I wouldn't do it, man.
Yeah, yeah.
They're not even in the right mindset. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
They're not even in the right mindset. Now, that's the person that'll get in trouble, man, that don't really understand any of this.
Yeah, and they'll be working with the people trying to do something to sabotage me or something. So, You know, I don't want to get my hands dirty in that. But my last question is, now I did attend a seminar and I had a few of your books, and I tell you what, this book right here, Commercial Warfare, dope. This is a dope book, my man.
Yeah.
And you was in Ohio. I didn't know you've been stomping around Ohio for a minute. But anyway, why should somebody go get Commercial Warfare? What's the best book, you know, that you have available to to purchase right now? Well, not to purchase, but to donate for right now. And why should they go get it? Because I've seen in this book, you go over a lot of different remedies of how to operate. But what makes it, you know, I could tell people, okay, well, if you read it, you know, and study, then you can understand the material that's being presented in the book. But, you know, from the man itself, why should someone go and cop the Commercial Warfare?
Well, first of all, that book right there will save them thousands of dollars, right? Like a lot of the procedures that's actually in that book, if they went to an attorney to do one of them, it would probably cost them a couple thousand dollars. You see what I'm saying? You got the book, you're going to learn how to do it yourself. All you have to do is look at the examples and, you know, just kind of configure some things around and put your name and stuff into place and so on and so forth. When at the same time, when you're using these procedures, it's actually teaching you how the law actually works. I mean, you got writs in that book. You got affidavits in that book. You got a different method of doing acceptance for value in that book. You got how to claim nationality in that book. There's so many different things in that book, man. And those things that's actually in that book has actually been used either in my life or someone else's life, so I know that they work. So versus someone trying to go online, pull something that may not work, the stuff that's actually in that book and all of the other books is things that I know actually work. And so I can't really say there's any best book. It depends on the person's situation that they're going through, right? Because every book, it got something different in it. You see what I'm saying? It got different procedures in it. Like the book Red Pill, Right Knowledge is geared more towards someone that's going through like child custody, right? And child support. There's a lot of maxims of law in that book in regards to that. And so I did that book when I was actually going for custody of my sons. And so many of the procedures that I actually used to get them is in that book, Red Pill, Right Knowledge. Now the corporation, that starts off like, talking about like, you know, motivation, trying to get people in the right place mentally. Then there's a lot of different writs and stuff in that book. It's actually different, you know what I mean, than the other books. And then the new book, The Inviolable Man, has a lot of different, you know, writs in that book. So it kind of depends on the person's situation. But ultimately what I did, right, like all of the stuff that I've been teaching at the seminars that people would pay attention, I started putting it in the books. You see what I'm saying? Because mm-hmm. they're not getting it all at the seminar. You see what I'm saying? Right. You're not going to get it in 16 hours, right? So you go, oh, yeah, this is what he was teaching at the seminar. So I'd be trying to tell people, yo, get the book, man. Get the book. They don't realize I'm saying, yo, if you get the book, man, you're going to get the answer right there. You see what I'm saying? Like, a lot of the slides and stuff that you see at the seminar is in the new book, The Inviolable Man. Like, a lot of that is actually in that book, man. Because I was actually constructing, you know, I was writing a book, like, you know, when I was doing like a lot of these seminars and so on and so forth. So, I mean, that's why they should actually have the book and the DVDs, because the DVDs have the actual seminar on them, man. And the reason I don't make these things available online, because you'll have some asshole that's out there that will download it for himself and then try to start selling. See, I've already caught cats, man. That come to my seminars, they get the DVDs, then they burning them. There was one dude, man, in Florida, like duplicating the damn books, taking it to a print factory, and then trying to store his own little damn group, man. I walk up into their meetings, like, yo, hold up, this is my material, man. Yeah, I was about to Tupac these, man. Just like, yo, I'll come back to you, man. I'm gonna leave and go and get me something to eat, man.
Every day, man.
Get a table over, man. I'm ready to Tupac these niggas, man. Real talk, man. Female, man. They was using a female to do it right there in Maryland. Her and this dude do up at my seminar in New York. Then I find out they try and teach classes in Maryland, man. What? That's my material right there.
Crazy, man. Look, I've been watching your videos since early, like, 2012, 2013. And, you know, so I know a lot of the information, you know, you present is right knowledge because I didn't apply it, you know. And I studied for some years before I even tried any of this stuff because, you know, I seen the accidents, you know, and the oopsie toochies and, you know, and what happened. You know, it was, I sat back in the cut and I watched, I observed and seen what people were doing, what was happening to people. But, you know, why, I know it's, I said it was my last question, but I got one more question. Why should somebody not consider, I won't say legal advice, but an attorney would tell somebody to stay away from this, you know? So why should somebody not be so gullible to believe what an attorney would have to say about this information in the first place?
Because first of all, once you take an attorney, you're done. Once you take an attorney, all of this stuff, all the codes, statutes, everything apply to you. Once you take an attorney, these courts immediately have jurisdiction over you. So it's not in their best interest, man. I mean, think about it, man. Let's say overnight you had 50,000 more people that was actually doing this, man. You know how much money that's taken away from lawyers? If you learn how to do this stuff yourself, it's already been an influx of people that's actually going into court representing themselves. Attorneys don't like that. You know why? They're not getting paid. Attorneys and judges get paid by going to court. So if they're not going to court, if the attorney's not representing anyone, he's not getting paid. An attorney is an officer of the court. That's the next thing. So anytime that you go in with an attorney, he doesn't have your best interest in mind. Corpus Juris Secundum, man. Volume 7, Section 4, says an attorney's first duty is to the court, to the public, and not to the client. That's a conflict of interest right there, man. But hey, man, people don't want to listen. Some people will wake up. Most people won't, man. They want to just stay in the matrix, man. Me, I chose to go down the rabbit hole, man. Red pill. Red pill right now, man.
Red pill all the way. I feel you. And I appreciate you. I appreciate the shirt. I see, I didn't stop you, right? You said I didn't stop you, right? So, man.
There's always a couple perfumes, man. When I was saying that, you had a jackass said, stop. Get out of here, man. You clown-ass nigga, man. You know what I mean? You always have them, man. You always have those crabs in the bureau, man.
It's all right. Niggas get hated on every day, B. You be all right. Be all right.
Yeah, I be all right. They will too, man. But all right, man.
All right, shalom, fam.
All right, shalom, man.